Hey, and welcome to the HopCast.
Thanks for coming back, everybody.
I'm Brad Chmielewski.
My name is Ken Hunnemeder.
Back again.
We have another special guest, and it's the same person. Boom! Rick Wildt.
What's up, HopCast Network?
Welcome back.
Thank you.
Rick Wildt works in the beer industry here in Chicago, also certified Cicerone, so you know he's legit. And we're going to drink some super legit beers today.
Super legit beers. They're going to be super sour. They're going to be super tasty. They're going to be delish. You're going to be jealous. Bottom line, you're going to be jealous.
Super.
Get ready.
Super. Yes.
What do we got?
All right, so we've got the 2010 vintage of their limited edition Rodenbach, which Rodenbach's always tasty beer. I have not had that before, so
I mean,
I'm looking forward to it.
The, you know, quintessential, you know, sour brand. If you're going to label a sour beer, you're going to think of Rodenbach right away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just like American car, you would think of Ford, not Chrysler. But that's neither here nor there.
Damn.
You know, so... It's a legit beer, you know. It's definitely the most widely popular as far as, you know, the sour beer program goes.
Mm-hmm.
And then we got this one that I just brought back from Portland out of Cascade. It's their Manhattan Northwest.
So what they're calling a Northwest-style sour ale, which is like a blend of a bunch of stuff aged in barrels.
Well, it's
bourbon
Manhattan
barrels
style because it's cherries and bourbon barrel.
With cherries, exactly. So... I think it's probably safe to say we're all in agreement that we're going to start with the Rodenbach, and then
definitely in agreement with that.
Go to the crazy
because this is going to be weird and probably mess
it's
up.
It's just going to be super nuts, just nuts stuff.
So let's go with the old classic, the old standby, and see what kind of new twist they put on it with this vintage reserve.
That poured out basically a dirty water color. Rusty.
It has a little bit of kind of a ruby cherry type of color on the sides.
I get a nice rich mahogany.
it's
gorgeous. Just gorgeous.
Out of that.
Just brown and kind of murky in the middle.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Just murk factor is definitely up there.
Right.
It got a pretty nice head on it. I think it kind of dissipated at this point.
Mm-hmm.
It was beautiful.
As soon as we get that GoPro cam, you'll see it.
Yeah, GoPro. Step up. Hey, it's 2013, HopCast. Get a GoPro.
Get ourselves a Kickstarter going.
Yeah.
Need a GoPro.
Losers.
It would take us like
GoPro.
4 months to get $200 for a GoPro.
Yeah, I'm never going to tell you guys seriously until you guys get a GoPro.
Just mounted on the bottle.
Aroma-wise, get some sour, some sweet, some fruit character.
Yeah, I get a little cherry. I get some raspberry. Definitely a lot of fingernail polish.
Mm-hmm.
Welcome to mani-pedi time.
Yeah, if you're going to drink this, you should probably just go get a mani-pedi.
Yeah, like, right?
Oh, that's not the beer. It's
hang out with girls pint out. And
shut up!
Yeah, it's okay. Tastes like a Smartie.
Huh?
Right? Really reminds me of Halloween when I was a kid. You know, dressing up, walking around the cul-de-sac. Getting all the Smarties.
I also grew up in a cul-de-sac.
So the great thing about beer is, you know, the aroma can definitely conjure up some great memories. And I remember when I was 8, you know, drinking Smarties and sour beer. Yeah. That was cool.
Just walking around in circles on your cul-de-sac.
Yeah, just cruising around the cul-de-sac.
But yeah, that tartness gets you, like, on the sides.
Right, but there's still a good amount of sweetness in this beer. And this is, and on the back of the bottle it says OK Jail barrel number 144. So I think they've got these giant like fooder style fermenters that are oak, and they're going just single barrel, no blending. But I have to assume that they might be blending back a little bit of just like fresh beer that's unoaked, fully fermented, but hasn't hit the wood yet. because it does have that sweetness. And if you're going to age a beer in wood with a bunch of wild yeast for about 2 years, it's going to be dry as hell. So that's, it doesn't say that on there, but that's what I'm thinking is going on.
Okay. I think they, in general, always blend to some degree at Rodenbach.
I think they do.
I think that's like part of what they do. So even just like Grand Cru every year is always like a partial blend, I believe. I could be wrong, but that's what I thought. Which is why they're able to produce sours like that on such a grand scale.
Right.
You know, they're an unbelievable brewery. But yeah, I mean, they definitely have mass marketed the sour as largely as they possibly can.
Yeah, and so they'll take that, they'll just sour some to high hell.
Yeah.
Blend it back with fresh beer, and now their yield is much bigger.
Yeah, like a 20 to 30%, I mean, maybe even higher than that, of definitely just fresh beer. Mm-hmm. To be able to get that sweetness, which we didn't see on the last two beers, you know, but it finishes, you know, it's tart, but it finishes very sweet still.
So that the nail polish thing you guys got in the aroma, what's the cause of that?
So that's a yeast issue. The compound itself is called acetaldehyde, and it's somewhere along in the fermentation something happened with it's always happening with wild yeast strains. More prevalent, I would say, than just like Saccharomyces yeast, but you can certainly get some nail polish out of certain just straight up Saccharomyces beers. I've seen them quite a bit.
I mean, there's a reason that it's called wild, because they're wild, you know, and so they, you know, just so much subject to bacteria more so than the regular, you know, yeast and, or the regular ale and lager strain, you know, and so.
Right, so it's not like a bad grade, like a, what, liquor when you distill that, you get like nail polish because it's like the cheap stuff, right?
And that's not, it's definitely not necessarily a bad thing. You know, especially with a vintage that's, you know, 3 years old now, that's going to, you know, develop over time even more so. So it's not necessarily a bad thing. Like, some people actually look for that. Okay. But
and is it pretty common to the Flanders style, or do you see it in, like, other stuff?
You'll see it in other stuff, but, I mean, I've certainly run into
it. Right?
Yeah, I mean, the Flanders Red that I made was just ridden with it. So when it first was packaged, it was beautiful, and now if 2 years later you go to it and it's just like, oh fuck. So it's kind of rough to drink at this point.
Okay.
Which is pretty bad because usually homebrewers,
yeah, obviously you messed up, dude.
You're just like,
good job on that one.
Drink their own and think it's awesome no matter what. So you know you screwed up if you can't even
drink your own beer. Okay. All
right. But that's what happens when you try to make sour beer. It's not always like a perfect scenario that
right
that can
you, and as yourself
in.
You can't blend it with another barrel or something else because that's all you got.
That's all I made, so you get what you have.
Better luck next time, Ken.
Yeah. Take some homebrewing tips from you for the next run around.
Probably should.
well
Ken, cheers,
and
guys.
Ken and I will finish these
right
off.
Yeah. I'm good already. Cheers, Hopcast world.
Ready for a Manhattan?
Absolutely. Always.
Back in action. Always ready for a Manhattan.
I feel like we should probably have a regular Manhattan with it and see how it's legit.
I wish I had the stuff to make Manhattans right now. I'd do that up in a heartbeat. But
we got this.
Alas, so. We don't. We'll make do with beer. We always do. So Cascade Brewing, Pacific Northwest. And they're a Manhattan Northwest style sour ale. So let's see what Northwest style sour ale tastes like.
Yeah, I mean, I have no idea. It is a what they call their a variation of one of their quads. So it's 11.5%. I believe barrel aged. I mean, it has to be barrel aged.
Mm-hmm.
And then probably something funky and something sweet. So I'm super pumped. That's for sure.
Yeah, let's get after it.
I love the color on that. Really nice, like cherry. Well, of course, cherry.
It's like cherry wood.
you know, beer and wood have a lot in common. This one's cherry wood. Last one was hickory.
Yeah, I got a couple little guys floating around in there, maybe.
Yeah, another kind of cloudy, murky beer.
Almost no head or a little bit, but it kind of goes away fast.
Dissipated quick.
Definitely not what I was expecting, that's for sure.
You're looking at an 11.5% beer, so head retention is going to be a little tough. I think given the size of the beer, it's got an all right amount of bubbles going on. But
it honestly just smells like carbonation.
Really? I'm getting the cherry for sure.
Are you?
I get some wood in there. I mean, not necessarily bourbon, just like a wood.
I mean, these are reminding me of those like Door County cherries, like that kind of aroma. Some spiciness that goes along with it.
Yeah. Very outdoorsy.
Yeah. Yeah, and you can definitely smell the heat on it.
Doing the Brett Porter right there.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Well, yeah.
It's kind of got a campfire thing going on.
Yeah, I got a little bit of smoke when I popped the top.
Yeah.
Now, that cherry really comes through on the tongue. Cherry,
you almost get like cinnamon initially. Like like an extreme
spiciness.
Like earthiness.
Mm-hmm.
Like initially, it's like pretty insane. But it like definitely like... Like, it's like, that was first to join the party, and then, like, some cherry shows up, and then, like, the oak is, like, fashionably late. You know, but, like, they're still just, like, having
like,
a giant
sorry,
party.
Guys.
Yeah, but they're still just having a giant party, like, right in your mouth.
But, yeah, now that I smell that smoke, I just can't get it out.
Yeah, that's awesome, though. Like, that's such a rendezvous, like, once it gets in your mouth, it's just like...
It's just like you have some cherries, like, boiling over, like... A fire.
Yeah, but I just get like
something
extreme, like cinnamon right away, like earthy, like spice, like almost like nutmeggy. Like
one of the beers that they use to blend in this is a spiced beer.
Oh, is it?
So that's where we're getting some of that. I think there's like a yeasty spiciness too, but there's also this beer.
The Noyaux.
Yeah, dude, it's got to be like something that's like cardamom, even like something like that, because there's like a noticeable spice. Like, right when it hits your tongue.
It's done so well, though. Like, I'm not a huge fan of spiced beers, but...
Yeah.
This is just, like, the right amount where you can't even really tell if it's coming from straight, like, fermentation. Or
yeah, no, this is really cool. This is really cool beer.
Mm-hmm.
It's a complete change from just the aroma. You know, like, the aroma, it's like you're almost disappointed. You're not thinking that it's going to be that exciting beer. And all of a sudden you sip it, and it's just like...
Boom.
Boom. Flavor. Flavor annihilation right there in your face. Just dominates your face with flavor.
Flavor domination.
It is. I mean, this is quite an interesting beer.
This is one of the better beers I've had. You get a ton of cherry.
Yeah.
11
You get
and a half.
So much cherry in
not
there.
Not getting a lot of bourbon burn or anything like that.
No, you get a little heat, but it's like, it's almost like, it almost goes from like cinnamon to like, you get like a straight like cherry pie flavor in the middle of it.
Right.
Of like biscuit, of like sugar, of cherries. And then it like finishes with like a little bit of heat on the very back end. I get a little heat on the very back end.
Mm-hmm. I'm finishing with heat as well.
Yeah.
But it's certainly not a bourbon heat. I don't know if it's just like blended so well together that.
Yeah.
I mean, but it is reminiscent of a Manhattan.
Right, because isn't that what you
degree.
Get a Manhattan?
Yeah,
you get the cherry,
that's a cool beer.
And then you get that little bourbon burn in the end.
Right.
That's a really, really cool beer.
Pretty cool. Yeah.
Good like job, it. Cascade.
Boom.
Thumbs up in my book. Boom.
Yeah, Cascade.
You got it. Did
Cascade
it.
Does some fun stuff. I think they're really like on the forefront of sour beers. They're just doing crazy stuff. Like sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. It's just,
and you picked this up straight from the brewery.
Yeah.
Am I correct?
Yeah. They usually have like maybe 5 or 6 bottles for sale when you go there. This was like $30 bottle, so they're kind of crazy. But
yeah,
we tried, I think, every sour beer they had that night. And it was like 20. Different sour beers.
Wow.
There was like 8 of us there drinking them, though, little tasters.
Right.
I'm impressed. You did it. You impressed me.
Not an easy feat, I'll tell you that.
Can't remember all the ones I had, but we tried them.
Yeah, doesn't matter.
Yeah, did it.
Well, Brad and Ken, I'm very glad to have been on HopCast.
thanks
being
for,
a special
thanks
guest.
For joining us.
Yeah, thank you for coming out all the way from like a mile away.
Yeah, do you know? Really nice. I do what I can. You know, it was Sunday. I had some other shit going on, but it really wasn't that important. So, you know, I made time. No biggie.
Well, yeah, we drank a couple of sour beers. Delicious stuff. And thank you for joining us.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Goodbye, Information Superhighway.